Thank you very much, and welcome to this discussion of Craig Wilder's book, Ebony and Ivy. Let me just say what a pleasure it is to welcome Craig back to Columbia, where he received his PhD, and where we awarded him the Medal of Excellence, one of the most distinguished awards we have. About a decade ago, he received this from the university. I'd like to also recognize his family. If his mother, Teresa Wilder, would stand up, and his sister, Gloria Wilder, and his nephew, Thoven Pierce. So I'll turn this over to Craig in just a second. I just want to say a couple of things. So this is important, and it's important for us to understand our own history as well as to understand the history of issues of race in higher education and in America. It's very important that we do that here. It's also something that we will do more work on. And our very distinguished professor, Eric Foner, has agreed to, over the next year, begin to teach and do some research on Columbia's history. And so that's a great venture. I also want to say that I think this is extremely important in the context of where we are with issues of race and ethnicity in America today. As some of you may know, I've been very involved in the issue of affirmative action and the United States Constitution. One of the things that happened that I think was close to a tragedy is that in the Bakke case, now 3 decades ago, Justice Powell said that it was constitutional for universities to take race and ethnicity into account if they did so for educational purposes, for diversity, but not as a way to rectify past injustices in American society. And he gave no particular reason for this distinction, but it has become absolutely embedded in American higher education. We all talk about educational diversity. We all say that this is an extremely important value, and it is. But you cannot understand that value. You cannot understand and even talk intelligently about the value of educational diversity with race and ethnicity without talking about the past and the legacies and the history of how we've got to where we are. It is the context of all of this that matters in making both this a better society, closer to the ideals that we set out to achieve through Brown versus Board of Education, and it's critical to educational diversity, however defined. And yet, as a society, as we talk about this issue, we are just not able to put it in a broader context, both of history and its present. This book, Craig's work, the work that surrounds it, is absolutely essential to understanding what we do and what we think today, and how we are to understand this across America. In some ways, we have a need for a new movement in America that does try to place all of this in a deeper, more historical context with the legacies that have come from this. We just had 2 reports in the past month or so that reveal that American public education is in many ways more segregated than it was in 1960, for example. And that New York State actually leads, unfortunately, in that level of segregation. The book that Ira Katznelson did when affirmative action was white, traces the public policies that created the circumstances that reinforced racism in America, and that continues forward as we talk about things like the inequality of wealth in America. And yet we have abstracted so much of that history from our current debates, including about issues like affirmative action and the recent Fisher case. So I think we have a very special reason for being happy that Craig Wilder is a graduate of Columbia, that he is a professor of history, the head of history at MIT, that he has written this book and other work, and that he will talk to us today. Craig, thank you for being here.
Let me just quickly thank President Bollinger. I was honored when Columbia admitted me as a student, and every encounter since then has been rather humbling, and this is no exception. To be here at this time to talk about this topic in this venue is really quite extraordinary. I should warn you, however, Mr. President, that you've started a real issue with my mother now. She's not going to stop telling that story. She's already renamed this event, and by the time she gets back to Brooklyn, she'll finish the whole revision of the history of what happened today, and she'll have us agreeing with her, actually, by the time we get there. Today I'm just going to talk very briefly from the introduction to the book, which I've just augmented a bit. Remember me to all my friends and relations. I wish you and others of the family as many as can write, to write me as often and tell me about everything and anything, Henry Watson Jr. begged his father. About everybody, anything I care anything about. Written from New York in November 1830, where the young man had booked passage on the schooner Isabella to Mobile, Alabama. The letter mixed a premature homesickness with a sense of youthful expectation. Watson was from East Windsor, Connecticut, just north of Hartford. And he was heading south to find work as a teacher in a plantation or in an academy. He carried a packet of introductory letters from his professors at Washington College, now Trinity in Hartford, and Harvard College in Cambridge, family friends including Professor Benjamin Silliman of Yale College and his father's business acquaintances. After graduating from Yale, Professor Silliman had considered a job in the South himself. And his brother Selig did leave Yale to become a tutor in Charleston, South Carolina. In fact, the Sillimans, Benjamin in particular, who helped to establish the sciences at Yale, paid for their tuition at Yale by selling slaves from their declining Connecticut farm. College, in short, initiated Henry Watson into the slave regimes of the Atlantic world. The founding, financing, and development of higher education in the colonies were thoroughly intertwined with the economic and social forces that transformed West and Central Africa through the slave trade and devastated indigenous nations in the Americas. The Academy was a beneficiary and a defender of these processes. College graduates had exploited these links for centuries. They apprenticed under the slave traders of New England, the Mid-Atlantic, and Europe. They migrated to the South and the West Indies for careers as teachers, lawyers, doctors, politicians, merchants, and planters. The end of the slave trade and the decline of slavery in the North did not break those ties. The antebellum South actually represented a new field of opportunity, where the wealth of cotton planters was funding the expansion of the educational infrastructure. The Isabella, the ship that Watson had book passage on, could carry a handful of passengers, and he had a small, comfortable cabin. He stored his trunk on board and then explored New York City while he waited for departure. He detailed his spending, documented his attempts to be frugal wherever possible, and he sent weekly updates to his father in Connecticut. Those communications were also filled with complaints about the things that he was realizing, like the cost of the books that he needed to further his education. Like Selig Silliman, Watson didn't intend to spend his life as a plantation tutor. He only wanted to go south to earn a salary for a year, improve his health in a warmer climate, and then study law. Later that month, this 20-year-old aspiring tutor boarded the schooner for his voyage south. An education at Trinity in Hartford and Harvard in Cambridge was reasonable preparation for living among the slaveholders of Alabama. The presidents of Connecticut's colleges and universities led one of the most extreme branches of the American Colonization Society, founded in 1817, to transplant free black people from the continental United States. New England's colonizationists cast African Americans as a threat to democracy and social order, encouraged campaigns to halt the development of free black communities, and even destroyed schools for African American children. Together, they linked with the colonizationists in the mid-Atlantic to bring probably about 60 to 75% of all the colleges in the Northeast into the colonizationist cause. They silenced debate about slavery, vehemently attacked abolitionism as the cause of political tension between the slave and free states, and distorted democracy. During a lecture for the Colonization Society at the Center Church in New Haven, Yale professor Benjamin Silliman apologized to his audience for even feeling ashamed about slavery. He then quickly pointed to the political common ground between the North and South. 13 states had already passed measures supporting colonization, he continued, because a large free black population was dangerous and undesirable. The ACS was embedded in Connecticut's colleges and universities. Yale's president, Jeremiah Day, was vice president of the National Association. The Reverend Ralph Randolph Gurley, a Yale graduate of 1818, was its principal agent. Gurley joined the Washington headquarters after his graduation and spent 50 years editing its journal, lecturing, fundraising, and writing policy. It was Gurley who conceived the name Liberia for the colony that the Colonization Society founded. Thomas Brownell, a slaveholder and the first president of Trinity College in Hartford. Thomas Gallaudet, who established a school for the deaf in Hartford, were also managers of the Connecticut Association. President Wilbur Fisk of the New Wesleyan University belonged. Numerous colleges and college trustees and faculty were part of the society, including Professor Silliman, who was vice president of the state association. Colonizationists also governed the state. Connecticut's entire congressional delegation, 2 United States senators and 6 representatives belonged to the ACS. Governor Gideon Tomlinson, an 1802 graduate of Yale, was the founding president of the Connecticut Society. His successor, John Samuel Peters, was a charter member. Justice John Thompson Peters of the Connecticut Supreme Court served as vice president of that organization. The board of managers included Congressman Ralph Ingersoll, a resident of New Haven, Congressman Ebenezer Young, Yale class of 1806, and several state legislators. Colonization was not, in fact, an innocent political movement. By the 1830s, colonizationists were actively engaged in campaigns to halt the progress of free black people throughout the northern states. In 1831, a group of Yale alumni and American colonizationists stopped the first black college from opening in New Haven, Connecticut, under the argument that it would compete with Yale for support, and under a fear, in fact, that the supporters of the new black college would actually outcompete Yale for the donations of America's philanthropic evangelical Christians. In 1832, they attacked Prudence Crandall School in Canterbury, Connecticut, and ended up putting Crandall on trial 3 times for the crime of educating black girls from outside the state. And in 1835, colonizationists helped to organize the campaign against Noyes Academy in Canaan, New Hampshire, in which a mob of 300 people surrounded the school in August 1835, dressed the building in ropes and chains, and then rotated teams of men and oxen over a 2-day period as they dragged the building through town a half mile to the rear lot of a Baptist church, and then took a field piece and fired it at the houses of all of the abolitionists who had dared to board black students. Harvard was therefore approaching its 200th anniversary at the time that Henry Watson went south, which meant that it was also nearing the bicentennial of its intimate engagement with Atlantic slavery. Beginning with the first graduating class, boys from Cambridge had been seeking fortunes in the plantations. By the time Henry Watson matriculated, Harvard's history was inseparable from the history of slavery and the slave trade. Moreover, Watson had been armed in college with theories of racial difference and scientific claims about the superiority of white people. The academy refined these ideas and popularized the language of race, providing intellectual cover for the social and political subjugation of non-white people. In a class with the Harvard anatomist John Collins Warren, Watson learned that in physical development, cultural accomplishment, and intellectual potential, black people sat at the bottom of humanity. Professor Warren also revealed that the most advanced scientific research confirmed the biological superiority of the boys in that room. It's likely that Henry Watson Jr. and most of his classmates already believed in the natural dominion of white people, and the scientific certainty with which most of his professors argued the primacy of Europeans and the backwardness of Africans only confirmed his views. Harvard, like Trinity, was a pillar of the antebellum racial order. Not only were the students, faculties, and officers and trustees white, but people of color came to campus only as servants and as objects. From Mobile, Alabama, Watson traveled north to Greensboro through, quote, plantations are very thick in that region. It was now December and he was focused on securing a salary. Quote, these regions seem to be a fine place for female teachers. They are in great demand, he reported despondently to his father. He still could not find a teaching job at an academy or on a plantation, and an opening at a public school would, quote, but little pay more than my board. While in Greensboro, he called upon Dr. John Ramsey Witherspoon, a South Carolina relative of the president and of the College of New Jersey and signer of the Declaration of Independence, the College of New Jersey being Princeton, and signer of the Declaration, John Witherspoon. The 6 months since Watson had left home had been spent to little profit, which was all the more disappointing and insulting in a place that he believed to be dominated by greedy planters and where, quote, the people are almost ignoramuses on some things. The doctors are miserable, the lawyers are not much better. To make matters worse, he lost his wallet from a torn coat pocket. Quote, it was one of the Christmas holidays and the streets were full of Negroes, he explained, so that I hardly expect to hear from it again. He went out with his host in search of the wallet but found nothing. The next morning, apparently unconscious of the irony, he dispatched, quote, a Negro to hunt for it, but unsuccessfully. In May 1831, this would-be tutor packed his belongings and prepared to leave Alabama on horseback. The idea of returning north by horseback actually came from Caleb Mills, a New Hampshire resident and a graduate of Dartmouth College. The two men passed on the road near Northampton, Massachusetts, as Watson was beginning his trip south and as Mills was heading back to the north. Mills later became professor of Greek and Latin at Wabash College and superintendent of education in Indiana. Watson took note of a particular piece of information from their exchange. Quote, he said that he had rode that same horse 5,000 or 6,000 miles at the rate of 40 and 50 miles a day, had just come from Kentucky. Short on cash, the young tutor chose that same method for his return. It was a perfect way to learn the geography and history of the region. Quote, I passed an Indian mound. Different from most, it appeared like a pyramid with a square base cut about 15 feet high. It is a regular square, Watson excitedly jotted outside Tuscaloosa. He had already seen Indian mounds and stopped to carefully examine one near Carthage. He began searching for mounds and artifacts. The very next day, Watson rode through a portion of the lands of the Cherokee Nation near Tennessee's border, but he saw, and I'll quote him, no Indians or Indian relics. That area was part of an enormous expanse of territory, tens of millions of acres that the state and federal government seized from Native nations and tribes, the most recent in a succession of human tragedies that transformed the demography of North America. Prior to the Great Dying, an estimated 4 million people lived in the greater Mississippi Valley. New waves of death had come with the expansion of European outposts 2 centuries earlier on the Atlantic seaboard. Violent raids into the interior from the Carolinas, transferred microbes inland, forced flights and migrations that upset the socioeconomic order of indigenous societies, altered age distributions, and caused abrupt changes in diet and health that made new diseases even more deadly. Watson's attention had been drawn to the remnants of these civilizations, monumental architecture constructed a millennium before Stonehenge. The largest ruins in the Mississippi and Ohio valleys, equal in size and crafting to the pyramids of Egypt, could hold St. Peter's Basilica and its gardens. These sites were once centers of civilization supported by trading networks that stretched across the continent. There's also a background to Henry Watson's interest in these archaeological remains. And as an undergraduate at Trinity and Harvard, he lived on campuses that were decorated with Indian bones and artifacts, and that hosted lively discussions of the impending extinction of Native people, legacies of a long relationship between colleges and conquest. The 1763 fire that destroyed Harvard Hall took with it a collection of human remains that included the jaw of Metacomet, King Philip of King Philip's War, and the skin of a Negro, listed in the inventory of the trustees as the hide of a Negro, tanned like leather for study. European nations founded academies to secure their colonial interest, and they supported these schools by exploiting the decline of Indian nations and the rise of African slavery. A young college graduate riding horseback over ethnically cleansed lands carved into slave plantations had plenty to ponder. Watson's mind was quite busy. He marveled at the beauty and the richness of the region. He saw planters driving Indians from the path of cotton and took notes on the crop economy, the hauling distances, and regional markets. At the home of a man who he met on the road, he watched 40 enslaved black people work 350 acres. Quote, cotton plantations go as far as the eye can reach. Corn, rye, and wheat abound, large bodies of Negroes at work. He was, it is fair to note, impressed with the rewards of human slavery. When he reached Kentucky in June, he used his letters of recommendation to gain an audience with Henry Clay, quote, said to be well off but not rich, Watson added after a lengthy, pleasant visit. Henry Watson's generation had begun to wrestle, albeit poorly, with the moral and social implications of this history. In September 1831, just shortly after Watson had returned to Connecticut, James Kent delivered the Phi Beta Kappa lecture at Yale's commencement. In 1793, Kent had become the first law professor at Columbia College in New York City. He bought a house, purchased an enslaved woman, and became a colonizationist and a prominent opponent of extending suffrage to free black people in New York State. In fact, under William Alexander Duer in the early 1830s, Columbia became one of the most extreme, New York and Columbia became extreme sites in the colonizationist cause. Kent celebrated the Yale chapter's 50th anniversary with a lecture that used science, theology, and history to proclaim the inevitable rise of the Europeans. It was the will of God, he began, quote, that the red men of the forest have been supplanted by a much nobler race of beings of European blood. It would have been a sin and a perversion of the duties and design of the human race to permit roving savages of the forest to maintain these lands as a savage and frightful desert. Henry Watson was quite happy to get back to northern soil, but he was also quite allured by the wealth that he had seen in the South. He studied law under Henry Barnard, a Yale graduate who later served as a state and federal education commissioner. Although he claimed to hate slavery, Watson left Connecticut for Greensboro, Alabama after just a couple of years. He set up a law practice and he became a slave owner, a sin, he confessed, but one that promised great benefits. Shrewd investments following the Panic of 1837 increased his wealth. He snatched up plantations and slaves in what once had been the home of the Creek Nation. He referred to his enslaved black people as his children, and he discovered the mastery and the charm of slavery. He spent his summers in New England, where cotton traders were dominating the commodities markets and massive cotton works were catalyzing an industrial revolution. Within a decade, Watson owned more than 50 people. Letters to his parents show that his motive was money. He disdained Southerners. Their religious practices were noisy and rude, their company was unenlightening, their culture was organized around avarice, but for all of his harsh judgments about the region and its people, Henry Watson Jr. had become an excellent Southern planter. Within two decades, he counted more than 100 black people as property. He became a founder and president of the Planters Insurance Company, and he emerged as a staunch defender of human slavery. On the eve of the Civil War, this Connecticut Yankee belonged to the planter elite. Long after the collapse of slavery in the mid-Atlantic and New England, northern colleges continued sending young boys like Watson south and to the Caribbean. The most successful cotton planter in the antebellum era was born, raised, and educated in Pennsylvania. Dr. Stephen Duncan moved to Mississippi after his undergraduate and medical training in Carlisle, Pennsylvania. He graduated from Dickinson College, which was founded by Benjamin Rush, an opponent of slavery and a signer of the Declaration of Independence. Duncan married into a Mississippi family, and by the outbreak of the Civil War, owned several cotton plantations, two sugar plantations, and more than 1,000 human beings. Henry Watson Jr.'s career as master of a degraded race forced to work the lands of a vanished people embodies central themes in the history of the American college. It provides glimpses into the complexity of that past. The course of Watson's life flowed through grooves that were carved across the society by emotionally wrenching and brutal historical events. Watson likely never appreciated the intimacy of his connections to Native and African people, the way that their lives unfolded into his and his into theirs. But his choices reflect that reality. His college education helped him to access the rewards of centuries of violent conflicts and demographic upheavals, and afforded him the privilege of turning the physical reminders and cultural legacies of those events into objects of tourism and fascination. What Henry Watson's life reveals is that by the 1830s, the American college was no longer, if it ever was, an innocent institution that sat in the backdrop of American history, but rather it had become, with church and state, the third pillar of American slavery. Thank you.
Thank you very, very much, Professor Wilder, for that wonderful talk. I'm Eric Foner of the History Department, and it's my pleasure to sort of moderate the rest of the program. What will happen is that I will speak for 10 minutes, Professor Karl Jacoby will speak for 10 minutes, Professor Ansley Erickson will speak for 10 minutes, and then we'll have a little discussion and then open up for questions from the audience. So thanks again to Craig Wilder for his book and his talk. He is a PhD from our department, the History Department, as you heard, and it's always a great pleasure to see your own students, first of all, get a paying job, and then go on to become distinguished historians in their own right and contributing so much to our knowledge of our past. Now, as you see on the front of this podium, the official name of this great institution is Columbia University in the city of New York. New York City is the greatest resource we have and sometimes the greatest burden also. Columbia's relationship with the history of slavery and race cannot be understood without looking very briefly at the history of slavery in this city, which is what I'm going to talk about, and then the others will move on from there. Although we tend to associate slavery with the Old South, it existed in New York City for over two centuries. More of the history of New York City took place with slavery than without slavery. And even after slavery ended here in 1827, New York City's prosperity was closely linked to that of the slave South. The history of slavery in this city begins in the earliest days of colonial settlement. In New Amsterdam, the Dutch West India Company, which governed this colony, used slave labor to build fortifications and other buildings, and the early settlers employed slaves on farms and in households and craft labor. In 1650, there were 500 slaves in the colony of New Netherland. Not a lot, but that outnumbered the number of slaves in Virginia and Maryland at that time. When the British took over New Amsterdam and it became New York in 1664, the British went on to dominate in the 18th century the Atlantic slave trade, and slavery in New York City expanded rapidly. New York merchants became actively involved in the slave trade as well as commerce with the plantations of the Caribbean. Slave auctions took place regularly at a market down on Wall Street. When King's College, our ancestor, was founded in 1754, slaves represented almost one-fifth of the total population of New York City, 20%, in other words. Ownership of slaves was widespread. They worked as domestic laborers, they worked on the docks, they worked as artisans, or in small farms in the hinterland of New York. In Brooklyn, which was then a collection of farms and small villages, one-third of the population consisted of slaves in 1771. In other words, slavery was central to the colonial economy here. It was not simply a peripheral institution, as people sometimes like to think. Now, during the American Revolution, many slaves gained their freedom, some by enlisting in George Washington's army, some by running away, but most actually via the British, who occupied New York City during the whole American Revolution and offered freedom to slaves of patriots, of people fighting for American independence. Many slaves fled to New York City in order to gain freedom, and when the British evacuated in 1783, they took about 4,000 slaves with them who became free. These were both New Yorkers and many from elsewhere who had fled to the city during the war. So slavery was weakened by the Revolution, but as other northern states moved toward abolition, slavery persisted in New York State. In 1790, New York City had a black population of about 3,000, and 2,000 of them were still slaves. Not until 1799 did our legislature enact a law for gradual emancipation, and even that law did not actually free any living slave. It provided that after July 4th of that year, children born to slaves would become free eventually after serving apprenticeships of over 20 years. In 1817, the legislature finally decreed that slavery would end 10 years later, and in 1827, slavery finally came to an end in New York City. But while slavery no longer existed, New York's prosperity increasingly depended on its relations with the slave South. As the Cotton Kingdom flourished, so did its economic connections with New York City. By the 1830s, cotton was the nation's number one export crop, and New York merchants dominated the transatlantic trade in cotton. Dozens of shipping lines sprang up, picking up cotton from the South, bringing it to New York City, and then having it shipped over to England and Europe. New York banks helped to finance the cotton crop. New York insurance companies offered policies that compensated slave owners on the death of a slave, not the family of the slave, but the owner of the slave was compensated. On the eve of the Civil War, J.D.B. DeBow, the editor of the era's most important Southern monthly, wrote that New York City, he said, was almost as dependent on Southern slavery as Charleston. The city's businessmen advertised in DeBow's review, which was actually printed in New York City, even though it was a Southern publication. And the economy of Brooklyn, which by then was a major city, was also dependent on slavery. Warehouses along the Brooklyn waterfront were filled with cotton, tobacco, and especially sugar from Louisiana and the Caribbean. In the 1850s, sugar refining was the number one industry in Brooklyn. Southerners were a ubiquitous presence in New York City. One journalist estimated that each summer no fewer than 100,000 Southerners visited the city, some of them just seeking a cooler climate, some of them conducting business, some of them students on vacation from Princeton and other colleges. Many Southern owners brought slaves along with them on their visits, until 1841, when the state barred owners from bringing slaves with them into the state, slaves could be seen on the streets of New York. In other words, even after slavery was abolished, there were still slaves around in the city. It was not unknown for a fugitive slave who had taken up residence in New York to read in a newspaper of his owner's arrival or even to encounter him on the street. Slave catchers from the South roamed the city's streets. As late as 1840, a group of law enforcement officers from Virginia boarded a ship in New York, seized a fugitive without a warrant, and removed him from the state with no legal process whatsoever. And racism seemed to intensify as slavery waned. In 1821, a new New York State Constitution prohibited nearly all black men in the state from voting. The kidnapping of free blacks from New York for sale in the South, something that people now are more aware of thanks to the movie 12 Years a Slave, that kidnapping was known in New York City, often with the connivance of public officials. Now, throughout our history, white Americans have prided ourselves on enjoying greater freedom than any other people in the world. For blacks, the situation has always been more complicated. In the era I've been talking about, hundreds of thousands of immigrants entered the United States through New York City, many seeking economic opportunity or fleeing religious and political persecution. Despite the hardships they encountered, New York was truly a gateway to freedom for most of them. Hundreds of fugitive slaves also passed through New York City on their way north. But especially after the Fugitive Slave Act of 1850 went into effect, very few could remain in the city without running a serious risk of being returned to bondage. For them, freedom had to be enjoyed elsewhere, usually in Canada, beyond the borders of the United States. Given this history, it should not be surprising that many persons associated with King's College and then Columbia College in the first century of our history, officials, students, donors, had a connection with slavery. Yet in the half century before the Civil War, New York was also home to a militant free black population that agitated for the abolition of slavery and a small but courageous cadre of white abolitionists. I want to point to one family in particular closely associated with Columbia, the Jay family. John Jay, the first Chief Justice of the United States and a graduate of King's College, was the first president of the New York Manumission Society, which pressed for abolition in the 1780s and 90s. His son, William Jay, who unaccountably attended Yale, nonetheless became a major abolitionist in his own right. And William Jay's will included a clause bequeathing $1,000, a significant sum in those days, to assist fugitive slaves on their way to freedom. William Jay's son, John Jay II, who was smart enough to attend Columbia, became the city's most important lawyer defending fugitive slaves in court in the 1850s. My point is that New York was a battleground in the irrepressible conflict between North and South. The city experienced in an acute form the Central American paradox, the coexistence of slavery and freedom, the long persistence of racial inequality in a society whose founding document says that all men are created equal. And as Professor Wilder has shown in his book, King's College and Columbia College could hardly remain immune from this paradox. I want now to introduce Professor Karl Jacoby of the Department of History and the Institute for the Study of Race and Ethnicity, who will talk more about Columbia's historic relationship with slavery. Professor Jacoby.
Good afternoon. As Professor Foner said, my name's Karl Jacoby, and I'm a professor of history and ethnic studies here at Columbia. In the fall of 2013, I taught what I suspect may be the first class ever at Columbia examining the university's relationship to slavery. It was something of a stealth project, not because I was trying to keep my course secret, but because I inserted the topic of Columbia's relationship to slavery into a long-running undergraduate class in the history department entitled The Historian's Craft. The Historian's Craft is a seminar designed to prepare history majors to write a senior thesis by familiarizing them with the issues involved in doing original historical research. To achieve this goal, there were certain logistical reasons why it made sense to study a subject like Columbia's relationship to slavery. The primary sources were as close by as Butler Library. Moreover, no subject in American history has generated as rich and sophisticated a historiography as slavery and emancipation. I could thus simultaneously introduce students to the challenges of working with original documents and to the theoretical underpinnings of the historical enterprise through a single, neatly contained case study. But logistics were far from the only reason I selected this topic. There's a profound temptation to conceive of history as distant, as removed from us in time and place. One powerful way to work against this impulse is to burrow into the history of wherever one is, for by doing so, we can begin to realize that history is not far away at all, but in fact permeates every feature of our day-to-day surroundings. This is what ultimately renders history an ethical enterprise. It erodes the divides we erect between past and present, enabling us to place ourselves in the stream of time, to see ourselves as products of a particular history, and in acknowledging this history and our connection to it, to reflect upon what our responsibility towards this new knowledge might be. I had personal reasons, too, for wanting to take on this topic. I was new to Columbia and wanted to learn more about the illustrious institution to which I was now connected. I had come to Columbia from Brown University, which had a few years before engaged in what is by most counts the first examination of a university's ties to the slave trade. I had seen how this undertaking had galvanized the campus with a series of important discussions about the role of the university and the complex issues posed by a present-day encounter with past injustices. I didn't possess any pretenses that our small one-semester seminar could equal what had been a multi-year undertaking at Brown by a team of prominent scholars. But I hoped that our seminar might lay the groundwork for later investigations, either by myself or others. And so I and my little intrepid band of student scholars dove into our subject, and some of those students are here with us today. We quickly discerned two things. First, that it was surprising that the fact that there existed multiple links between Columbia and slavery was surprising. As Professors Wilder and Foner just discussed so eloquently, slavery was prevalent throughout the North in the 18th century. It was especially prevalent in New York City, both in terms of the number of enslaved African Americans and in the city's extensive maritime ties to the massive slave systems of the South and the Caribbean. Based on the ubiquity of the peculiar institution in American life, there was no way Columbia could not have been shaped by the culture and economy of slavery. In this respect, it simply mirrored the American society in which it was embedded. Second, based on what we were discovering in the archives, slavery could be found everywhere and nowhere at Columbia. One gets glimpses of its presence in numerous documents. When George Washington's stepson attended King's College, the precursor to Columbia, for instance, he brought with him to campus an enslaved African American named Joe, presumably to take care of him while he studied. Some early benefactors of the university were slave owners or involved in the Caribbean trade. Some professors were slave owners. Frederick Barnard, who was a president of Columbia during the Civil War and for whom Barnard College is named, owned slaves when he lived in the South before coming to Columbia. Even John Jay, an early alum of King's College and the first president of the New York Manumission Society, as Professor Foner mentioned, was also a slave owner. In fact, as contradictory as it may seem to us now, he bought a slave named Benoît in Martinique shortly before becoming the head of the Manumission Society. But these traces were often tantalizingly sparse and elliptical. Part of the problem was that Columbia moved twice during its early history, and in the chaos of relocating, it disposed of many of the documents that scholars at other universities have used to create detailed portraits of slavery at their institutions. But part of the problem, it seems to me, was that slavery was so normal, so everyday, for so many of the people connected to Columbia during these years, that they considered it unworthy of reflection or commentary. As a result, it left little imprint on those documents that do exist. As historians sometimes quip in such situations, fish do not see the water. That is, one does not see something whose presence is so familiar that it's taken for granted. This brings me to the final point I want to make today. Sometimes one hears the accusation that digging into a topic like Columbia's relationship to slavery is an exercise in self-flagellation designed to make us wallow in guilt about a difficult past. I would urge us to reject this assertion. None of us were alive in the 18th and 19th centuries, therefore none of us should feel guilty for what did or didn't happen at Columbia during those years. What we should feel a responsibility towards is how we act now in the world that this history has bequeathed to us. Moreover, I would assert that the university's capacity to critically examine itself demonstrates academia at its best, an admirable example of the Enlightenment's goal of not accepting established wisdom, but rather seeking out the truth no matter where the path may lead. There are few spaces in our culture today for such rigorous self-reflection, and we need to foster and celebrate this aspect of the university, even as we recognize how it failed to live up to these ideals at other moments. But most of all, I've found that learning about Columbia's past has made me reapproach how I live in the present. I often ponder the fact that few of the students, professors, administrators, or trustees at Columbia during its antebellum years had much to say about slavery, even though now, of course, we consider the enslavement of one's fellow human beings to be the era's preeminent moral dilemma. So it makes me wonder, what's going on now that people in the future may consider the great challenge of our day? And how will they assess our response? Will they see us face up to our great challenge? Or will they wonder how it was that this issue was right in front of us, yet we ignored it, went about our daily routine, and did nothing? Thank you.
The last speaker is Professor Ansley Erickson, also a PhD from our history department and now an assistant professor at Teachers College.
Good afternoon. It's a pleasure to be here with you today. When Professor Wilder traces how slavery and American colleges grew up together and in mutually reinforcing ways, he opens up many questions that extend beyond the university and beyond the 19th century. Consider two examples from recent news. Could his transatlantic history of the false science of racism help us think about the fact that, as we've recently learned from the U.S. Department of Education, American schools suspend black preschoolers at a rate 3 times greater than their white peers? Does it help us understand how we are a nation that therefore sees 4-year-old children's play through the lens of racist censure? Or what might his work help us do in thinking about the fact that, as President Bollinger mentioned, we are here in New York, a place of broad diversity, economic vibrancy, and the most racially segregated school system in the country, UCLA scholars just recently informed us. I have to list just these two possible paths out of Professor Wilder's work, among so many others, to acknowledge how difficult my job is here, to choose a topic among the many that his work calls us to engage. He asks deeply historical questions, but implies very large contemporary ones as well. I want to focus on a line of inquiry that grows outward from his work, but in a direction that may be less noticed. Professor Wilder looks, as we know, at the intertwinings of slavery and the college. What happens if we expand outwards from there, from racialized slavery to think about American labor systems more broadly, or stretch from the college to American American education overall? The question then is how our education system and our labor system have been and remain intertwined. The intertwining reaches well beyond the end of chattel slavery, with a wage labor system that today produces extraordinary and still racially marked income inequality. As Professor Wilder has shown, in the era of slavery, universities helped match people to their places in a slave labor system. They helped inculcate elite white men in the work of mastery, and helped further the structures and ideas that kept people of African descent enslaved. Surely, education did not function only in this way, even within a slave labor system. An 1830 North Carolina statute made the teaching of reading to an enslaved person a crime. The law itself testified to the reality that even as the state tried to ensure a lack of education to enforce servitude, enslaved people pursued education. They made learning a mode of resistance, a place for the making of freedom. Even as early American colleges reinforced slavery, enslaved people and free black Americans used education differently, to make space to assert their humanity, to stand from that basis and critique the falseness of the labor system that constrained them. This is the core tension that I want to explore today, between uses of education that fit people to the labor system they know, and views of education that help them to perceive, to critique, to seek to transform that labor system. It is a tension well illustrated in the first decades of the 20th century within a wage-labor system ruled by Jim Crow. The Northern philanthropic Julius Rosenwald Fund sought to expand high school education for Southern black students. They offered to fund buildings and pay teachers. They did this in Little Rock, Arkansas, amongst many other places. There, Rosenwald officials carefully studied and then designed their school to respect the boundaries of Jim Crow labor. They promised classes only in those areas of work white people had rejected, assuring local white school administrators that, quote, this school would interest itself only in trades obviously Negro, end quote. The school might be new, but what it would produce would be quite old. Seeing this as an attempt to fit their children for injustice rather than ready them for justice, black community members pushed hard against the plans. In other settings, they resisted more quietly. Some communities took the classrooms labeled chauffeuring or gardening and taught within them the literary subjects or classical academics they wanted. Without naivete about the shape of the local labor system they faced, they pushed not only for education to suit their children, for work, but for education that gave their children a foundation from which to perceive and fight against injustice. This critical and democratic education tradition continued into the 1960s. Freedom schools, citizenship schools, and richly educational organizing traditions and practices of the Black freedom struggle illustrate it well. But although these efforts never entirely dissipated, their relative place in our education discourse has weakened over the last half of the 20th century. Beginning in the 1960s, federal policy and public rhetoric embraced a view of education that was more ambitious in some ways. Education itself was said to fix poverty, close gaps of inequality. But this view of education was also less ambitious in some important ways, because it satisfied itself with making mobility by producing future workers for the extant labor system. Somehow, the very way that education had at times stymied change was now the route to make change. Gradually, the idea that education needed to produce discerning and critical citizens drew less attention. Although we can find a history of education for citizenship and critical democracy that runs far back, it is the image of education as fitting students to our present labor system that dominates current conversation. There are many possible examples, from current curricular shifts to renewed federal interest in vocational education. This conversation does not look the same as it did in early 20th century Little Rock, when the Rosenwald Fund tried bluntly to reinforce a racist wage labor system through its schools. It appears, in fact, in a quite different and seemingly positive idiom. It appears in the now familiar images of neatly uniformed, usually black and Latino children working seriously away in their classrooms, while college pennant flags line the walls or adorn the ceilings. It embraces a language of college going, of increasing expectations, that carries widely appealing ideas about mobility, about opening opportunities rather than closing them. But we should notice still the limits of this rationale for education. It is still education designed to fit students to an extant labor structure. It is to fit them some notches higher than they might otherwise have been, but it is nonetheless driven chiefly by an idea of school as preparation for work. Yes, skills individually acquired, individually carried, can help move students to a better place in this labor system. But that movement is not only highly individual, of course, but highly contingent, and from the perspective of the collective challenges facing our democracy, highly incomplete. Preparation for individual mobility isn't the only education problem. It is also an education problem when the lower tier of our labor system includes work so ill-paid and so tenuous that even full-time employees can scarcely support themselves or their families. We are in a moment, whether it will be sustained or not, we don't know, of heightened public attention to wage inequality. The wage inequality produced by our present labor system is jaw-dropping. The basic gaps in income are larger than they have been in nearly a century, with the wages of the lower 40% of our economy stagnating, and those of the top 10%, not to mention the one, skyrocketing. Meanwhile, in terms of the median wage, black workers have actually lost ground since 1979. The promised links between education and mobility in this labor system are beginning to look unstable as well. A generation ago, some college or a college degree was a much better predictor of moving beyond low-wage work than it is now. High-skill, high-wage jobs are growing much more slowly than low-skill, low-wage jobs. It was never fully tenable to hold that education was the engine of American mobility, especially if we pay attention to the deep inequalities by race that continued to be visible inside both education and labor. But it is even less possible now to think that fitting students to a deeply unequal labor system will somehow transform that system and produce equality. Schools can work hard to help jump as many of their students as possible from the low-wage pool into the higher-wage pool. But as doing so becomes harder, we have to ask at what point the education conversation needs to shift from trying somehow to make everyone a winner in a game with steep odds, to consider how democratic political engagement might be needed to change the terms of the game. Real decreases in American inequality have come in the times when Americans have made equality-favoring political choices, ones that acted directly on our labor system, in recognizing and encouraging unions, in supporting strong minimum wage standards, in expanding social benefits through work or government provision. Worker preparation alone, whether college-bound or vocational, is not enough. It seems easiest to talk about our current labor system as having one kind of educational problem, the need for workers. But in fact, our current labor system provokes a different challenge. What role can education play in addressing a labor system that is producing incredible inequality and a political system that is, to date, tolerating it? Professor Wilder has given us rich historical examples of how education has worked to slot people into and produce the ideas that reinforced a slave labor structure. His work should provoke us to reconsider what ties between education and labor we see today, and what better links between education, democracy, and labor we might need. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much, Ansley. Okay, thank you. I wanted to give Professor Wilder an opportunity, if he wants, to respond to any of the comments that have been made by the three of us, if anything occurs to you or you want to add on the basis of what's been said.
Nope.
No. All right. In that case, before we go to questions, which we will do soon, I wanted to actually ask then, I will ask you a specific question, to maybe comment a little further. Professor Jacoby, of course, has spoken about the work his course did on beginning this, looking into Columbia's historic connection with slavery and some of the issues of racism that you talked about. From your research, what impression do you have? Your book was not about Columbia specifically, no. But it is mentioned.
Yeah.
What's your impression about, is Columbia sort of pretty typical of these other fairly elite colleges you're dealing with, or is it more extreme, the connection, less extreme, et cetera?
Yeah, I think the book took me 11 years to write, in part because I didn't want any one college to hold all the blame. I didn't want it to be a book about Harvard, and then in chapter three, Columbia was sort of similar, Princeton sort of similar in chapter four. And so partly, Columbia falls into, in the second chapter, Columbia takes the foreground, and I compare it to other schools, but it's in particular because Brown had already done its report on Brown and the slave trade, and I wanted another active slave trading port to look at that wasn't repetitive. And so I chose New York and King's College, and really what you have in that period, I think, which is critical to the story, is in the North American colonies, the British colonies, there are only three colleges up until the early 18th century, right? Harvard in Massachusetts in 1636, William and Mary in Virginia in 1693, and Yale in Connecticut in 1701. And then between 1745 and 1769, the number of colleges more than triples to 10. Seven new colleges are added, beginning with Codrington in Barbados and Princeton in New Jersey, the College of New Jersey, and ending with Dartmouth College in 1769 in New Hampshire. Right? So the colleges that we know are established in that period, that next group, including Columbia. And it's exactly at that moment, between 1745 and 1769, that the African slave trade is peaking. This is the height of the slave trade, and the new colleges are all established with very close and intimate ties to to the African slave trade, and slave traders in the Northeast are, in fact, overrepresented on the boards. They're overrepresented on the board. Brown, the College of Rhode Island, has more slave traders than any other college on its board. But Columbia, King's College, gets more sons of merchants and traders than any other colonial college. And the competition, the new competition, is a competition for the support of elite slave trading merchant families in the Northeast and slave owning plantation families in the South and the West Indies. There's an extraordinary reorganization of the economics of higher ed. And so Columbia falls into what's in fact a 18th century story, an 18th century story about the rise and expansion of higher education in the American colonies and the close attachment to the slave trade at that moment. Yale, William and Mary, and Harvard then begin reorganizing their financing in order to compete with these new schools and make new overtures to the South, the West Indies, and the wealthy slave traders in Britain.
And as you mentioned, I think, in the talk, in the 19th century, Columbia is pretty connected to the colonization movement. This is correct, right?
Yeah, it's absolutely. You know, William Alexander Durer, who's president of Columbia in the 1830s, is also president of the New York chapter of the Colonization Society. He issues the inaugural statement in which basically the logic flows that a free black population is dangerous and unwanted, and colonization is the appropriate response, the removal of an unwanted population of people. But it's also the beginnings of a northern intellectual attempt to negotiate a solution to the regional tensions between the North and South, and projecting an extraordinarily racist version of colonization, an anti-black version of colonization, as a way of creating political harmony between the slave and free states. And New York, Columbia, you know, Princeton, where the movement is founded, and Yale, which staffs the colonization movement, are all, in fact, really overrepresented in the colonization scheme.
Mm-hmm. And one other question. Your book also, and this really I also want to address to Ansley, your book also deals, as your talk did, with not just sort of economic connections with slavery, but the sort of promotion of racism, scientific racism, particularly in university education, so that the universities are helping to create the intellectual legitimation of slavery and colonization. Now, I'm wondering, this is no longer, I guess what I'm thinking of is in terms of what Ansley was talking about is going on today. This no longer exists in our universities, presumably. Racist pseudoscience, right? Although there are...
Yeah, it's making a comeback. Yeah.
It's making a comeback, yeah. Right. Okay, that is true.
It never quite dies.
Yeah. All right. That's true. That's really what I'm trying to figure out, if whether that has been really put in the past or not.
In fact, actually, you know, in the book I begin with the rise of medical schools in the North American colonies as the sort of first place to look. Columbia gets, King's College gets, the second medical college in North America. The first is at the College of Philadelphia, now Penn, and then Columbia. Both of them actually begin with the with American students, graduates of what's now Princeton, Penn, and Columbia, heading to Scotland to study medicine, and then returning to North America. Actually, they're racing back, they're competing to see who will establish the first American medical school. Racing back, but they can't establish medical science without actually having bodies to practice upon. And it's the colonial governments transferring the bodies of deceased Negroes to the new medical faculties for them to experiment upon. In fact, at Philadelphia, it's an anatomy that takes place right in what's basically the state house. At Columbia, it's Samuel Bard, whose father, John Bard, is actually a surgeon here in New York and is Washington surgeon for a point, sends his son to Edinburgh to study medicine. When Samuel comes back, John has invested in a plantation on the Hudson River, which he renames Hyde Park, and he begins purchasing slaves. He also arranges for his son to marry one of the Kruger family daughters, one of the leading slave trading families of New York. And so Columbia's medical school begins, in fact, with this intimate family relationship to slavery and the slave trade, but also with the transfer of the corpses of the enslaved to the medical college. And Columbia rents its rooms, actually, in New York Hospital, which is directly across the street from the Negroes' burial ground. And so the medical students, in fact, prey upon the African cemetery in the evenings for corpses. And so really from the very beginning of the rise of medical science, the science preys upon the enslaved. And one of the things that then happens is the institutionalization of that science. The creation of medical schools, science professorships, science programs, brings science under the dominion and the control of the very slave traders and slave owners who financed higher education. And so they begin incentivizing an especially pro-slavery and anti-black science. Or one of the great contradictions of science in the 18th century is, as Nancy Steppen once pointed out in The Idea of Race and Science, early race scientists were anti-slavery. Two generations later, they're rabidly pro-slavery. And I would argue that part of that transformation is the institutionalization of science, the funding and incentivizing of a pro-slavery science.
I want to ask Ansley or Karl if you want to add anything to anything we've been talking about.
Well, I'll take this connection to medicine as an opportunity to come back to your question about whether we have a racist discourse in the academy or not. I think in education and in health, and this is one of the points of conjuncture, there's a great deal of discussion, much of it genuinely well-motivated, around the idea of racial disparities and the very important work done to try to understand how to perceive statistically and in large scale patterns that represent fundamental inequality. The trouble is that when you generate a lot of these statistics and yet don't spend an equivalent amount of time explaining richly why they are what they are, they leave a tremendous amount of space for people to apply the explanation that they carry, so that we may not explicitly create space for scientific racist notions, but without challenging or without filling that explanatory space, that space exists and people fill it.
Go ahead.
In terms of picking up the theme about science and the institutionalization of racism, I would just add that this continues well after, obviously, the end of slavery, the end of the Civil War. And one example you could point to very easily is the institutionalization of eugenics in a lot of higher education. And Columbia has a mixed history on this as well, that eugenics was prominent here as it was at almost every other Ivy League university. Franz Boas was an anthropologist here, an early voice raised against it. But these sorts of issues do continue well into the 20th century, if not all the way up to today.
And of course, Columbia is the sort of academic origin of a deeply racist historical view of the Reconstruction era, which from Dunning and Burgess here around the turn of the century, which had profound effects in many areas of our society. I want to open the floor for questions from the audience, but there are two microphones in the aisles. So I want to invite people who want to ask a question or make a comment to please go to one or another of these microphones, and then we will call on you. Then everyone else in the hall can hear you. So, okay, the first person over at this microphone, go ahead, ma'am.
Hi there. My name's Alice LaBrie. I'm former U.S. Department of State. I live here in Harlem for many, many years. I would like to say I was told by genealogists and people in my family that a lot of our people were educated by the Jesuits. So what role did the religious organizations play? And could you comment on that?
Sure. In New Spain, the Spanish American colonies from the Caribbean to Mexico on the mainland all the way south down to Peru, the Jesuits had established some of the largest of the universities, and the first universities in the Americas are the Catholic universities in New Spain. So the very first one, the Autonomous University in the Dominican Republic, which is in Santo Domingo, is actually still there now. It's 100 years older than Harvard, established in 1536, and running basically continually since then. The Jesuits supported their colonial universities, and the Catholic ordered priests support their colonial universities by establishing rather grand haciendas with slave labor. And so slave plantations actually fund the faculties, the students, the erection of the buildings. The Jesuits are actually the largest slave owners in colonial America up until the point of their expulsion in the 18th century. In the United States, Catholic higher education arrives relatively late, but not that late. For the most part, it's the late 18th century, early 19th century. But we know, for instance, that the first school, the first college on the other side of the Mississippi River is probably St. Louis University, a Jesuit university in St. Louis. And St. Louis is established by Jesuits who own slaves and bring their slaves to that spot to erect the university. And so there's a close connection between all of the Christian denominational schools and American slavery.
Did these Jesuit institutions admit black students at that time?
For a very short period in the 1500s, there are some African students who attend a few of the schools, but they're basically driven from campus fairly early. And the campuses, most colleges established in the colonial period are established with the rationale of evangelizing and missionizing native people. And they turn to African slaves and the slave trade as a way of subsidizing that overall mission.
I see. Yes, ma'am.
Hi, thank you. So one of the
Pull the mic up a little closer?
So, can you hear me now? Is this all right?
Yes.
Okay. So one of the questions that Professor Jacoby posed that I was really appreciative of and interested in following up was what is the big problem of today and how will people look back on it? Right now, Columbia currently has $8 million invested in the Corrections Corporations of America, which is the world's largest, not the world's, but the country's largest private prison company. Public intellectuals, scholars, activists all over the world regard the phenomenon of mass incarceration as the latest iteration of a collection of institutions and legislation geared towards oppressing marginalized and vulnerable communities, low-income communities of color. In an economic and sociopolitical tradition that extends all the way back to slavery. Can you speak to your perspective on the link many people have drawn between Colombia's current investment in mass incarceration and its former investment in the formal institution of slavery? And what would accountability for our complicity in the system look like at a place like Colombia? And so that's just a question for all of you. Thank you.
Okay. As someone who teaches in the New York State prisons through the Barred Prison Initiative, and for several years now, I'll be back in the fall. Mass incarceration, I think, is one of the critical issues, generational issues, that faces the nation. And I'm fully in favor of not just divestment from private prison corporations, but in fact actually broader social action to bring about awareness of the crisis of mass incarceration and the social consequences of mass incarceration in low-income families for many people of color, but also increasingly for working class and poor white people across the United States. We can't incarcerate ourselves to freedom, justice, equality. We actually have a formula for achieving real democratic society. And incarceration is not an ingredient in that.
Yeah, I mean, I totally agree with that. I think future generations, to go back to what Professor Jacoby, the question he asked at the end of his talk, future generations will certainly look back on this time and see the incredibly high rate of incarceration in this country, really only at the level of one or two other countries in the world. As one of those things that it's pretty hard to understand how it could exist, how it could survive, and how, even though people like yourself are agitating against it, how it still has not generated a kind of mass movement yet to eliminate it.
I mean, I would just say I asked that question, and when thinking about how I would answer it, I have sort of three answers, and the top of the list would be mass incarceration. Is clearly, and the continuity with slavery is very clear, and this has been argued brilliantly in that book by Michelle Alexander, The New Jim Crow. I also taught in the prison system at Brown, for the Rhode Island prison system, and it's an incredibly wonderful teaching experience. It's right up there with teaching the Ivy League, as a matter of fact. I would also potentially add to my list, since I have the forum here, this is I was thinking a lot about global warming as maybe one other one, and I also think about the toxic environment that we're creating for our children and all the sort of neurological issues that young children seem to be having. Those are, for me, seem to stand out as three substantial moral dilemmas that we face today. And I guess I would just add that even though there's only a small group right now, we need to remember the abolitionists were a very small group as well, right? But I think history was on their side, right? And so you need, if that's what you believe, you need to keep going, and I support that.
Yes, sir.
Yes, good afternoon. My name is Joe Brown, a graduate of Columbia College, 1966. My question surrounds the core curriculum. If anyone's familiar with it, would you place that in the scale of one of the remnants of white supremacist philosophies from the ancient days?
Wants to answer that one? Go ahead, Craig.
Well, I wasn't a Columbia undergrad, so.
I'm not quite sure I pick up the exact question.
Is the core
the legacy of the core?
The legacy of.
Should we understand the core as part of the legacy of white supremacy at Columbia, if I understood the question?
Oh, the core. Mm. I actually took the core once a long, long time ago, but I've never taught it for some reason or another. I'm not sure what the answer to that question is. I believe in a core very strongly. I do not believe that the core is untouchable or cannot be amended, so to speak, to make it perhaps more representative of the world we're living in. I don't know.
I mean, as a historian, I'd answer that question historically, which is to say when the core first emerges in the 1920s, this is a moment of, you know, this is a high point of eugenics, this is a moment of intense sort of need for, after World War I, of intense identification with America and certain notions of Western civilization. So I think its roots, to be honest, are not the most attractive. I think you could probably, I would feel comfortable saying that there is a white supremacist tinge to its roots. I think that in principle, the core can be neutral. It's the idea is, how is it, what, I think this is a continual debate. I come from Brown where there was no core, so this is one of the biggest things I've had to learn about working here. The idea that everyone should share a certain body of knowledge at Columbia, I think, is a wonderful idea. The challenge is figuring out what that should be, and I think that's always going to be an ongoing discussion here at Columbia. And in some ways, it's great to have the core because it forces us to have this discussion about what is the body of knowledge that we should all share, right? And so in that respect, I am a firm believer in the principle of the core.
Yes.
Hi, my name is Lauren Whitehead. Thank you. This has been really enlightening and troubling in a number of ways. But my question is mostly for you, Professor Erickson, because I'm a teacher here in the core. And I just filed my 2013 taxes, and that was very troubling to see that I made $11,000. And I spend a lot of my time with students here at the university in the core curriculum, giving them part of the things that we were just talking about is essential to this shared knowledge that all the students would have here. And so my question is about whether or not teachers and educators have always been sort of undervalued pawns in this system as well, and whether or not when we think about the relationship and the ties between labor and education, do we always think about it in terms of the people who are being educated, or rather has when and how has the value of the educator changed historically and in recent history as well? Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes.
So I think.
Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
I think that this question is, for me, very helpful. It helps me to explain a little bit more about how I came to the thoughts on Professor Wilder's book that I had, because the last time I saw him, I was on a panel with him and with a third historian who wrote a history of called Uncivil Rights, which is traces the relationship between civil rights organizing and teacher union organizing, in chiefly in New York. And so the apparent theme of labor was very vivid there because of her questions about teacher labor in relationship to the questions about colleges and labor broadly that Professor Wilder's work raises for me. So I think it's a core issue, and I think that my choice not to address it here actually reflects the kind of tension that this work by John Aprilo is trying to address, which is the difficulty that we've had historically of having a single conversation about education in which teachers as workers and students as people with rights can be understood in the same conversation. And we're still having, that's still a fundamental problem that we're not moving forward on to the best of my understanding. So I think that it's actually, I don't have a tidy answer. I just think it's a really important and generative point to ask, what is hard about that? What is hard about thinking about teachers and labor in the same conversation that we're having here? So thanks for the question.
Yes.
Hi. I wanted to return to our discussion about what we can do now as far as Columbia's investment in mass incarceration and its direct legacy to slave institutions in the U.S. And since we don't have the opportunity very often to have President Balaji here, I want to actually address this to him. What can you do? What commitment can you make to moving this money that Columbia is directly invested in Corrections Corporation of America, as well as G4S? If you want, I can move the mic over to you, if you'd like.
You know, the issue of investment, divestment, as you well know, has been a controversial one for many, many years. Columbia, back in the 1980s, became the first Ivy League institution to adopt a policy of divestment from companies doing business in South Africa, which stimulated many other colleges to do the same. That was the result of a very long and large student movement on this campus. I cannot speak for the trustees nor the people who invest Columbia's endowment. I am certainly not qualified to do so. I do think history shows that eventually people respond to large-scale movements of one kind or another. So if one is very interested in that issue, one has to then build from, as Professor Jacoby said, most movements begin with a very small base. Some of them grow very large, like the movement against slavery. And I don't think that just walking into the office of whoever's handling the investments is going to win that argument, but creating more and more awareness of the issue and pressure on the issue will non-violent, peaceful pressure has the possibility of achieving change in this and many other areas. This man knows more about it than I do.
Yes, that's who the question was directed to. Thank you for your response, though.
Do you want to speak at the mic, Lee, please? Yeah.
The important thing to say is that there's a process. It's been set up for a long time. There are students on it. There are faculty. This is a difficult issue. That is what to restrict the investment of the endowment in. There's been a lot of discussion about various things over the years. As Eric Foner just said, apartheid in South Africa is a classic example of a decision by this institution and a lot of other institutions to divest. The same is true of companies that produce cigarettes. That was an issue that during the 1990s. There's now this issue. You really have the opportunity to make your case in this process. It comes through that process, been to me and then to the trustees. So, I am thrilled that you have raised a number of questions that make people like me feel uncomfortable. And, that these are hard problems and they're difficult. You want to come and make the case as strongly as you can. And we'll try to be as fair and judicious and yet passionate about this as well.
Thank you. Okay, I think we have time for the two final questions over here. So. Go ahead.
Greetings. I found it especially illuminating how Professor Wilder noted that the post-secondary the university system is essentially the third pillar of American society and the foundation of this nation, and how essentially inextricably linked is commerce and labor with the university system. In that regard, how did the Reconstruction era of the 1860s through 80s, how did that shape university culture within the Ivy Leagues, and how did industry and the class conflict movements affect this transformation?
That's volume two.
Yeah, right.
But I think
that requires a long answer, probably longer than we have time for here.
But I'll give you a quick of it. I think part of the crisis, the Civil War, does result in a reexamination of the place of education in American society. And so you see a new commitment to public schools, North and South, a great fight for public education in the South, coming out of the Civil War, and a recommitment to public education in the North.
And the first black colleges.
The first black colleges to survive are actually established basically in the decade before the war. And some of them are actually there already. They're high schools that get sort of promoted up to the college level, raised up to the college level, and start doing advanced instruction. And you will also again see, and you can actually see this online at the Library of Congress website, the Photo and Archive Division. If you look at universities like Hampton, and Howard in the aftermath of the war, Native American education and African American education get combined again. And Native students, particularly veterans of the war, begin arriving on campus at a lot of the historically black colleges will now have Indian colleges in much the same way as colonial colleges once had Indian schools or Indian colleges on campus.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so final question.
Hello. Mm-hmm. I am the very proud older sister by 1 year of Professor Wilder.
In several months.
And as a physician, I really wanted to have you guys comment a little bit about what we're seeing in health disparities and its relationship to both the education process within American medical schools, but also how we're operating our healthcare system. Right, with the closure yesterday of Obama Cares for Us, we saw 7 million Americans enroll in the new Affordable Care Act, but we still have 25 million who are not enrolled and are not getting good health care. And Columbia University has one of the biggest emergency rooms in this city, and you guys are seeing about 100 patients per physician per shift in that emergency room, at the same time saying that we want to practice preventive health care and not have people use our emergency rooms. So I'd really like you guys to comment on that, because I personally think there's a direct link between what we're seeing in our prison pipeline and our health disparities all across this country.
We have one of the most irrational health systems in the world. I don't think there's anyone who could deny that. The Affordable Care Act is a step in the right direction, but only a small step. There are still gigantic disparities. There are still many people, as you said, without insurance. There are still tremendous gaps between what ordinary people can get and what other people can get. And, you know, it's totally absurd that a country that spends so much money on health care comes up with such poor results compared to most other, you know, industrialized countries in the world. So you're right, the disparities are great, and they're similar to the disparities in education and in many other areas of our society. And as Professor Erickson pointed out, inequality is rising and it affects all these areas. So we need to try to do something about that. On that note, uplifting note, I want to thank Professor Wilder again for coming. And let me just go ahead. Let me give him a nice round of applause. And I will point out that his book, his excellent book, Ebony and Ivy, is for sale out here, and I urge everybody to read it. So thank you all.